Scant rain that fell on the dry Iranian desert brought us a beautiful sight. Is a sign that autumn is here on the desert. When autumn comes, the nomads move from the pasture, their summer home, to a warmer region, taking their livestock with them. Was transferring hundreds of sheep all by himself, playing the handmade flute. Women and children who carry tents and household goods take a different route from menfolk with their livestock. The boy said that he had walked the full distance of 200 kilometers, taking a whole week. But he has to walk 5 more days before he reaches Sarax, near the border of the Soviet Union. It will be his winter home. It's tea time for the nomads. After they rest the sheep near the water, they gather up the dry grass to make fire. Then they make tea. Whilst drinking tea, they chatted about the death of 10 sheep this year, due to an epidemic. In their village, the grass didn't grow well, and the sheep became thin. So they had to sell them cheaply in town. Sheep are the most precious asset of the nomads who live in the desert. They can tell which sheep belongs to them no matter how the herds get mingled up. After tea comes time for a nap. This strange shape of dress is called namad, a sleeping bag of a nomad. It is made of felted wool, which is effective insulation against the strong sunshine of the desert and the severe cold of winter. The population of nomads in Iran is estimated at between 2 to 4 million, but the number is gradually decreasing as more and more nomads choose to settle down in towns. The main artery of Silk Road used to run through the northern side of the Khovir Desert in northern Iran. This road, which could be called the North Route of Iran, stretches a distance of about 3,500 kilometers, passing through the Alborz Mountains and ending up at Isfahan, the ancient capital of Iran. Silk Road, which was once the traveling route of caravans with camels and donkeys, has turned into a paved highway in the middle of a desert.
خداوند مرا
The only remains of the old caravansary, which once served as the lodging of caravans, could be found near the old highway. This caravansary was built in the 12th century and is believed to be the largest in Iran. The walls of the rooms and the roof are crumbled down, but the outer walls and gates made of bricks are still kept intact, reminding us of their prosperous days. The room for livestock is near the entrance. It was quite rare for the desert merchants to achieve their goal of travel without difficulty. On top of scarce food and drinking water, bandits and highwaymen haunted them, often robbing them of valuable merchandise and even life. Probably for the purpose of consoling the hearts of exhausted travellers, the walls of the room are decorated with reliefs of unidentical designs. Ancient kings of Iran used to build this type of caravansary in various parts of the country as part of an effort to protect and encourage trade. This is one of the summer residences of the nomads in Shafiabad village. The inhabitants of this region, who live in a mud house with a dome-shaped roof, are called the Kochan Kurd. The entire tribe had been nomads until about 10 years ago. On the day when we visited the village, almost all the people were out to go to the village square. Today happens to be the most important day for the Muslims of Iran, the day of Ashura. It marks a day of martyrdom for the Muslims of the Shia sect. Thirteen hundred years ago in the 7th century, the world of the Muslims was destined to be divided into two major sects. The Shia, based mainly in Iran today, and the Sunni, whose majority live in the Arab world. In the midst of a dispute which erupted over the caliphate, Hussein, son of Ali, who was a cousin of the Prophet Muhammad and the fourth Islamic caliph, was slain by his opponents on October the 10th, 680, at a place called Karbala. Revered and remembered through the entire Islamic world, Hussein was proclaimed by his followers as the supreme leader of the Shia. At the village square, an Islamic priest is relating the story of Hussein's martyrdom to the villagers. Friends, comrades, our Hussein fought a brave fight, and leading only 72 men, met his death at the hands of an army of thousands. Hussein's son, poor boy, Ali Asghar, was left all alone, afflicted by thirst. He wandered about the dreadful desert before being massacred. This tragic day is called Ashura, and people of Iran have long made it a custom to annually hold a religious ceremony in lamentation of the martyrdom of their leader, Hussein. People pound their own body to share the pain their martyr suffered, thus refreshing the memory of grief and anger. Mashhad, near Shafiabad, is the third largest city of Iran and the largest holy place for the Shia sect. A black banner, hoisted in grief over Hussein's death, is fluttering at the mosque. On Ashura Day, the entire land of Iran boils with excitement. This is particularly true of Mashhad, where the grave of Ali Reza, the eighth leader of the Shia sect, is to be found. Mashhad is indeed an epicenter of the country's religious fervor. Believers parade through the street calling the name Hussein. The destination of their march is the shrine where Ali Reza's grave lies. What the men in black shirts hold in their hands is a bundle of chains. The Iran-Iraq war of today has produced many casualties. So, on the day of martyrdom, grief and anger seem to grow greater than ever. Nobody is allowed to enter the shrine of Ali Reza. Believers pay a visit to the shrine and touch or kiss the walls, seeking a blessing. Leaving Mashhad behind, we proceed with our journey along the Alborz Mountains. the area is an endless wilderness, which reminds us of the wasteland of the Gobi Desert, which we passed through during our trip to the Chinese Silk Road. In the middle of the wilderness, a herd of camels are at play. On a closer look, we could see some double-humped camels among the single-humped ones. Camels in the Taklamakan Desert of China were all small and meek, with two humps. This is the first time we have come across the double-humped camels since we crossed over the Pamirs. At the foot of the Alborz Mountains lies the Gorgan area, whose inhabitants are said to be mostly Turkmen of Turkish ancestry. Every day except Friday, a carpet fair opens in the street. Turkmen with Turkish hats of black felt bring their carpets here to trade. Carpets of this fair are characterized by their simplicity of appearance, using a lot of red yarns, and by their warmth. Having examined the size, pattern, and color schemes of the carpets, and having negotiated the price, bills are now ready. Holding bills, men firmly shake hands. The negotiation has ended successfully. Prices vary from $200 for smaller carpets up to $1,000 for the larger ones. Some distance away from the fair, another round of carpet transactions is also underway. Women who have brought carpets they themselves wove are selling them to the merchants. The carpet dealers are trying to beat down the price of carpets the women brought. The dealers quickly return to the market to sell these carpets at nearly double the price they initially obtained them for. Traditions of the Silk Road people are still kept alive among these shrewd merchants. Turkmen, who once dominated Central Asia, were horse-riding people noted for their dauntless spirit. Today, they not only live at the foot of the Alborz Mountains of Iran, but also in the Republic of Turkmen, which they established in Central Asia in the Soviet Union. Elborz Mountains run from east to west of northern Iran. It is this mountain range that prevents the moist air of the Caspian Sea from entering Iran and divides this country into a fertile farming area and a dry desert area. Mount Damavand is the highest peak of the Elborz Mountains. This narrow and winding path in the Elborz Mountains was trodden by various foreign tribes who invaded Iran on a number of occasions. When Hulagu Khan, grandson of Genghis Khan and his large Mongolian army, assaulted Iran in the 13th century, they used this mountain path. According to the Book of Marco Polo, a peculiar religious group built a fortress in the deep mountains of Elborz and held it until it was destroyed by that Mongolian army. The fortress was called Alamut. It was built deep in the western mountains of the Elborz. Marco Polo said that Alamut was a paradise beyond description, where an old man named Hassan Sabah from the mountain lived. He would look for a young man who would meet his demand, and if he found a suitable one, Hassan Sabah would put the man to sleep with a narcotic and take him to the fortress. When the young man awoke, he sent him on an assassination mission. What kind of person was Hassan Sabah? Unfortunately, the villagers at the foot of the Elborz have never heard of such a legend, nor of anybody named Hassan Sabah. Path becomes steeper and narrower. To reach the fortress, we must cross the valley of the Alamut River, flowing between the mural precipices. Hassan Sabah, old man of the mountain, belonged to the Ismaili sect, a faction of the Shia sect. He plotted against the believers of all the Muslim sects other than his own, because he regarded them as heretics. His first targets were the Sunni sect and the Seljuk tribe of Turkey. Gradually, he widened the range of his deadly plot, and in his prime days, he is believed to have sent his assassins to as far as Turkestan in the east and Syria in the west. After a leisurely 3-hour mule ride, we finally arrived at human habitation. It was an old village called Gozekhan at the foot of Alamut. Villagers told us that we could reach the fortress in about 1 hour. Whether because they were not used to seeing foreigners, village children were rather reserved at first, but soon they became friendly and took us around the village. Spinning yarn from wool is a woman's work. This mother and her child, baking bread, if they had heard of Hassan Sabah, but they knew nothing about him. Gozekhan is such a peaceful village that we can hardly believe that it once kept that dreadful assassination group. It's but a short way to the fortress, but the path becomes steeper and steeper. At last, the fortress of Alamut came into sight. Alamut means an eagle's nest. True to its name, the entire impression of the place is that of a huge rock mountain. The book of Marco Polo records the outlook of the fortress as follows. Inside the fortress is an elegant palace decorated with superb paintings and plated with gold. Four rivers there contain wine, milk, honey and water respectively. What's more, charming beauties are to be found playing musical instruments, singing sweetly and dancing. Hassan Sabah, old man of the mountain, would take young men aged between 12 and 20 to this palace to let them stay there. The first thing he did was to offer them hashish, which would put them into a deep sleep. The drug was effective in deluding young men into believing that they were in the real paradise promised to believers in another world. When the young men awoke from their deep sleep, the old man said to them, "Now go, you only have to kill. If you succeed in assassination, you can return to the paradise. If you fail, you can still rest satisfied that you have done something valuable. You will be rewarded by being raised up to heaven." The young men climbed down the mountain to carry out assassination just as they were told. Today, the remains of the fortress have nothing to tell us of those days gone by. The fortress of Alamut was impregnable. It was protected by the soaring mountains behind, and there was only one route leading to the fortress. In fact, it could have resisted against the whole world. However, the tenacious attack by the Mongolian army lasted for 3 years. And finally, in 1250, the Alamut fortress, deprived of the supply of food, surrendered to the Mongols. That brought to an end the assassination group led by Hassan Sabah, old man of the mountain. It lasted for 8 generations, or 150 years. All of their fortunes and possessions were confiscated and completely destroyed by the Mongolian soldiers. Was Hassan Sabah, old man of the mountain, a mere leader of a fanatic assassins group? Or was he a real religious reformist? 500 years since then, assessment of Hassan Sabah is still divided, adding another mystery to the Silk Road. Having crossed over the Alborz Mountains, we headed southwards through the Kavir Desert. What lies ahead is Isfahan, an ancient capital which once boasted of its glory. Isfahan is a beautiful city, which was once referred to as the jewel of the Islamic world.
نکلید بصره رو میخواد بدی، نکلید بغداد رو، به فضل خدا با رزمندگان عراقی و نیروهای مسلمان عراق هم کلید بصره را ازت خواهی روی لفت هم کلید عراق.
Every Friday, a square in front of the mosque in the center of the town becomes filled with people praying in the direction of Mecca.
مردم اصفهان، زن و مرد، ای شمایی که همیشه اون چنان در صحنه بوده اید که همه ملت ایران پی برده و امام هم پی برده و امام هم از مردم اصفهان تشکر کرده. در این هفته جنگ به دیدار خانواده های شهدا.
Since the Islamic Revolution, religious fervor of Iranians has been escalating to an unprecedented level, with Imam Khomeini in the center. A highly spirited chorus of prayer envelops this ancient desert city. In the Middle Ages, Persia was subjected to a succession of invasions and foreign rule by Arabs, Turks, and Mongols. But it finally established a dynasty capable of unifying the entire Persian nation in the 16th century. This was the Safavid dynasty. It was during this period that Iran began to flourish. The Safavid dynasty, as well as its fifth generation king, Shah Abbas, built bridges and highways in various parts of the country and protected these Silk Road travelers, constructing caravanseries and bazaars. They designated Isfahan as the capital and filled the city with gorgeous buildings. Shah Abbas launched into the construction of this mosque, but it was not completed until 25 years later. The mosque is said to be one of the most beautiful structures of the world. Some 500,000 pieces of ornamental tiles in vivid colors are clear evidence of the past glory. From the 16th to the 17th centuries, Isfahan indulged in such extravagancy that people even called it a half of the world. The vicinity of Isfahan, which produces pomegranates, fruit of the desert, is also a noted production center of Persian carpets. In this small factory, we found several women weaving a carpet, calling to one another to make sure of the design of the pattern. Everything is done manually. Usually it takes 2 or 3 years before a whole piece is completed. Persian carpets are a wonderful artistic product of the Silk Road. The history of Persian carpets is old, dating back to the 5th century BC. Both Arab textiles, which were brought to Iran in the 7th century, and Chinese fabrics in the 13th century, stimulated the people to devise new techniques of dyeing and weaving. This is a typical scene of a Persian market. Isfahan's bazaar is covered under a high arch-like arcade, inside which run many streets crossing and winding like a maze. They stretch quite a distance, and the number of shops is said to exceed 2,000. Dresses made of Persian print hang from the ceiling. Techniques of gold work and metal carving developed in Isfahan were brought to as far as China by way of the Silk Road. This shop selling Persian prints is one of the oldest in the bazaar. The owner, who is 80 years old, says that it's hard to know when his ancestors opened the shop here. He recalls that in his childhood, the bazaars were busy with itinerant traders with loaded camels, and so various foreign speeches could be heard in the shop. He would often hear stories about India and Egypt told by those travelers who had brought various exotic articles. So the bazaar was not only a place where merchandise was traded, but also an international information center. Leaving the oasis behind, travelers on the Silk Road continue their journey in the desert. The eastern route leads to Kabul in Afghanistan, as well as Merv and Samarkand in Central Asia, while the western route will take you to Baghdad. Iran, with its glorious past and the echoing voices of Muslims reciting the Quran, is a country which bridges the East and the West, just as it did centuries ago.